Well, as we all know, the international mechanism of protection of human rights are quite established in a number of conventions and institutions. Unfortunately, they are usually ineffective. And so one of the main issues that we, as not only academics, but especially as a non-governmental organization that work for the defense of human rights, is to try and match the gap between the great international standards that are in theory and the practice. As our colleague said before, the case of Turkey is exactly one of the most worrying cases of a state that theoretically should be bounded by a number of international conventions, including in this case the European Convention of Human Rights, but does not implement all this. Well, speaking about the general mechanism of protection, I mentioned the European Convention. So the European Convention, as we all know, is an instrument that was established by the Council of Europe, exactly in Rome in 1950. And it is the only regional organization in the world that has a court, a real court of human rights that can sentence, can issue sentences against any member state or state party of the convention for specific violations of articles of the European Convention. So theoretically, we in Europe, and Turkey is one of the countries of the European, of the Council of Europe, we should be particularly safeguarded by this mechanism. But it is very difficult to arrive to a sentence in favor of the person that claims that his or her human rights have been violated. First of all the national remedies should have been already concluded, so the trial and the appeal trial, eventually a cassation decision should be arrived to the end in the country. Then the person is entitled to present an appeal to the European Court of Human Rights. The European Court will decide whether the appeal is admittable or not, and then comes the rest. This story can take many years. And when finally the court, that is anyway a very important mechanism, finally the court decides that the rights of this applicant have been violated, the court can issue a sentence obliging that state to do something, to restore where it is possible the rights of the person, to give eventually compensation and so on. But before arriving to this, a state, especially a state with an authoritarian regime, will do all that is possible not to arrive to that point. For instance, torture. The case of torture is one of the crimes that is more difficult to demonstrate. Even if a state has ratified the optional protocol to the International Convention on Torture, that includes the creation of a national preventive mechanism, there are many ways how a state cannot really enforce this. So the person that has been tortured in usually in a prison or in custody at the police will find very difficult to prove this torture, especially if there is no help from the relevant authorities, especially if the judiciary is not really completely independent. I saw this also in other countries. I visited several times Kazakhstan, for instance, and in that country I had the opportunity to speak with a number of high-level officials up to the general prosecutor and so on. And all they were explaining, well, we have the national preventive mechanism, but to have it in the legislation and to implement is something different. Then there is the principle of universal jurisdiction. You know, in some cases, when it comes to serious violations of human rights amounting to crimes against humanity, for instance, every state can decide to do a trial against some person, even if this person is not a citizen of the state and if the fact have not taken place in the country. So this is basically the principle of universal jurisdiction, but applies only in very serious crimes with an international relevance. I mentioned the crimes against humanity can be genocide and so on. And so it's difficult to prove that a particular crime amounts to this level. Very often, torture, for instance, is committed in the close, in the darkness, in places where, as I mentioned, it is very difficult to get the proofs for the person who was victims of such abuse. So the principle of universal jurisdiction is difficult to apply, especially in this specific case. Another mechanism is the Committee of Human Rights, the Human Rights Committee of the United Nations, that was established by the ICCPR, the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, which entered into force back in 1976. So this committee is composed by 18 experts, and these experts may receive complaints also from individuals. And this committee has the capacity to address the complaints. How they address the complaints? When they receive sufficient evidences that a serious abuse has been done, they can write to the authorities of a certain state, they can ask for more information, they can suggest remedies, they can publish reports. So it is a sort of quasi-judiciary system, but again, being a quasi-judiciary, they are not entitled to issue sentences. So they can anyway issue consideration. So what the UN Committee of Human Rights can do is to issue considerations. The importance of these considerations is the fact that they can point out politically, let's say, more than juridically, the abuses committed by some state. It is a long process, and there are few cases when these arise to the end. Similar mechanisms are for the group, the working group of the United Nations on arbitrary detention. I have been also using this kind of statements, considerations by the UN Working Group on Arbitrary Detention, that in a way similar to that of UN Committee of Human Rights may address a case by writing to a state and asking those authorities to, for instance, to free a person that is unjustly detained and to do remedies. Well, all these are, I think, the most important, the most relevant international mechanism for the protection of human rights. Then there are there is the Council, the UN Human Rights Council, with its Universal Periodic Review, the UPR. It means that more or less every 5 years, each of the 193 member states of the United Nations will be examined in its human rights records by all the other states. So even non-governmental organizations and other can send reports to all the state of the United Nations when it comes to the UPR of some particular state and indicate some violation of human rights that is of particular concern. Then the UN Human Rights Council will, with some procedure that takes more than 1 year, ask the member state to explain that situation, and the member state will answer, usually in a written form. But of course, a democratic state with independent judiciary, with free media, freedom of association, free lawyers, will have no difficulty to answer in a clear and serious, sincere way to the questions. While a state under UPR with an authoritarian regime, without freedom of the media, without freedom of the lawyers, and without independence of the judges, will find every possible pretext to answer in a not acceptable way. Finally, there is a system that I have to mention and to which we at the Italian Federation for Human Rights, together with other partners internationally, are devoting a campaign that is a non-judiciary method. It is a non-judiciary tool, but I think that it is quite important. It is the so-called Magnitsky legislation. So it comes from the case of a lawyer who discovered some fraud committed by high-level officials in the Russian Federation about 10 years ago. He was imprisoned with the accusation of libeling, of defamation, etc., tortured in prison. He died in prison. And after this, in the United States, because he was defending the business of some Anglo-American businessman, Bill Browder, in the United States was approved the first Magnitsky Act that after a few years became a global Magnitsky Act. So in the name of that Russian lawyer who died in prison, the United States first, and then other states that have a similar legislation, decided to sanction not a state, but those individuals, usually high-level officials, who committed, presumably, but with quite strong evidence, serious abuses of human rights or acts of grand corruption, and who were unpunished in their country. So how they are sanctioned? They are sanctioned in an administrative way. They will not get the visa for the United States or for the other states that have a similar legislation. Their assets will be frozen. They will not be able to conduct a number of international economic activities. This is quite serious because some of these persons not only committed human rights abuses, but at a level of corruption very high, they entered in possession of a huge amount of money that should belong to the citizens of their country or to some private business. And so freezing their assets is quite serious for them. This may apply also to high-level personalities of government. It is the case not only in the Russian Federation, but also in several other states. I remember now Sudan, for instance, but in many states, this can happen. So it is a tool that may be effective, not only by punishing people that otherwise will not be trialed in their country, but also by encouraging the states to act against grand corruption and serious violation of human rights. So the states, and I'm going to conclude my speech, states that have a Magnitsky legislation currently beyond the United States are Canada, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, the United Kingdom, Kosovo, that is not recognized by all the international community, and Australia is going probably to have a Magnitsky legislation soon. At the European level, we had in the last few years statements by both the Council of Europe and different institutions of the European Union that would favor the creation of a common European Magnitsky legislation. So I am available for any question or further information, and I thank you very much for your attention.